Good morning, and welcome to another week of policy writing, I guess. I'm going to slowly pick up on where I left off last week. Basically, last week I finished with an episode about confining GNOME Terminal and some of the programs that you might want to be the user to be able to run from the terminal, like for example the mail program. Now let me make clear to you that the GNOME terminal is not yet fully functional. I think probably is. I'm pretty sure it is, because we haven't actually tested the menus. So for example, you might be able to create a new profile, or change some settings, and that's not supported yet because it doesn't even create any stuff in the user home dir. So if you create a profile, it should probably save that profile in your home directory and create some content there. We haven't tested that yet, so it's not allowed to create a new profile right now, but there's a lot of polishing to do overall in the policy, so that's something that should be done, that we will do probably later. Today I'm going to just slowly pick up and try to confine something that I think is reasonably simple and also related, and also one of the programs that basically is one of the default programs that GNOME needs to run, which is the system control monitor, the GNOME system monitor. Basically showing the processes, and since we in the last episode also took care of processes that a user can list using the ps command or the top command, this is kind of related, so we should probably this would probably be a good time to also take care of that, or to look into that. So with that said, I will first unload the don't audit rules so that I can basically see what's going on in the system. And then I will go into the permissive mode and simply run the system monitor. Actually, before I do that, I should probably just add a transition so that the transition works right away. That's probably the best idea. So let's just do that first. Here is the type enforcement file, and then let's go all the way. Let's just find it. Gsystem mon, I think it was. Actually, not. Gsysmon, is it? Gsys. There it is. So, just like what we did for the GNOME terminal with regard to domain transitions, we should also apply that to the GNOME system monitor, because it's also run by the GNOME shell. You basically run it from the menu, and that's basically GNOME shell running it. So this the same applies as what applies to terminal. Oops. So let's copy this over and just adjust that to our requirements. So let's replace some stuff here. So that it reflects this scenario. That way we'll have the domain transition set up, and we can start right away with looking at what it actually needs to run. And again, one could simply don't allow this by making this conditional. Oops, yeah, this is it, yeah. and this is it, and we also need to make sure that the transition goes right, so don't forget anything. It's still early Monday morning, so I'm prone to make errors, which I try to prevent, of course. So we should now have the domain transition set up. So let's save and exit this, and let's just make an install. See if I have it somewhere in here in my menu. So it's loading. And let's set enforce 0 and then just see if the log output is reasonably clear at 9:38. We're at 39 right now, so we're pretty clear. Let's log in. So we're in permissive mode. And I'm going to simply run the system monitor. The system monitor is probably all the way below. Yeah, here we have it. And I'm just going to run that. And close that. And then see what ABC denials that produces. And let's see what we have. These are the usuals, the usuals, the usuals. This is all the usual. And here we have sysmon. So let's just first peruse everything and then later go to the system monitor. Yeah, so it's basically currently only the system monitor that has stuff that we need to focus on. So what we have here already, so just like usual, we need to focus on domain transitions first. So here we see that some stuff gets executed, but we don't actually know . This seems to be just checking for execute rather than actually executing that stuff. And since this is also done by GNOME shell, let's just first have a look before I make any assumptions. But it seems that it's pretty straightforward to allow it to check for execute. So we're going to grep for execute. And then for less it, and then just see if it's really system monitor that's doing the checking. And it seems to be really it, except for, yeah, this one is hidden on purpose. And these are really executed. by the system monitor. So that's really just shows that that's really the case. So let's just go to the G shell part and then see how we dealt with that with regard to GNOME shell. So basically what we did here for now, and we need to probably and I'll make just a note of that, allow get attribute but audit access exec, something like that. That might be eventually be best to do, because it doesn't actually execute it, seems. It doesn't even open the file. So what I think it does, two steps basically. First it gets the attributes of the executable files, and then it checks for execute. That's basically what I think is going on, but that's something to be investigated later. For now we're just allowing it the execute permission and the get attribute permission. So we're basically going to do is we're going to extend this rule here, and then just also allow the system monitor the same thing. And I'll just copy this over and edit that. G sysmon. And the same for this rule here. So basically, just like shell, the GNOME system monitor also does this checking of these files, which is which I don't really understand why it's doing it, but I determined that it's really the system monitor that does that, so we need to just allow that. So that's done. Let's go ahead and go back and see what else we have. So we took care of a lot of stuff already, or a lot of these denials in here. So what we basically could do is just copy over this stuff and work through them a little bit from the policy. That might be a good idea. Let's paste that in here. And then just work through them. Because what we can do is now make some assumptions. First, let's remove the stuff that we already allowed to make it a little bit cleaner, and then just have an overview of what's going on. Nautilus. Terminal. Itself. File roller. Events. These are all the stuff that it's checking for execute. So if you can, let's just see what it does. So basically, it needs to basically have that access to the deconf temp stuff. So let's just find something that does similar and then just use that. Here we have, for example, the JavaScript console doing the same thing. And all these programs basically need to do that. So we can basically, and I'll just add that below, add that in, and then just see. Yeah, it's basically the same permissions here, so we just basically can adjust this and just build in this support. So we are now kind of assuming stuff, but on the other hand we're just pretty sure that this is needed. Because we found at some point you'll see patterns. You'll see just see stuff that all these domains use, or a set of domains use, and then you can basically see a pattern. like for example this font stuff, like so all these programs need to be able to read fonts, these graphical user interfaces. It's obvious, it's expected. So basically what we can do is just go to a previous, to a similar program, graphical user interface, it also uses fonts, and then just grab the rules from there and just allow it. It will save us some time, hopefully. Basically, in upstream policy, that's basically done by using the macros. So here we have the font stuff that's needed. So we copy that. That's from abort applet. And then just go all the way below again, and then just add that. And you could basically make subsections already, and just say read decon of manage deconf and read fonts, so that you basically have these permissions grouped. So the same goes here, just copy this, adjust it, and then remove it from the list above. Let's work our way through there. And then just remove the ones that related to fonts from here. Now we have, oh yeah, right, so the X stuff. So we can basically ignore this one. This is the append to read and append to XDM home, which we basically silently deny for everyone. And this one can be removed. Also, this is check exec. Let's just take care of X server and XDM. So that should probably be these XDM warranty, wasn't it? Yeah, XDM warranty. So let's just take care of these as well. Some basic stuff that you need so that it can interact with the two. And that same goes for the tempfs file read write, which doesn't, oh yeah, it does show up. So we can basically put that in the same basically subsection. So this read write is due to X server. It's, this one sucks, but it's just, fortunately it's just inherited, so that's, paste that in, and then I guess the get attribute of temp, oh that's not there yet. So we can remove these. Then we have access to sysfs. It seems to be reading sysfs, so let's have a look at the full. I know the user also reads sysfs, so we can basically get it from there. So let's grab these, go below and add those as well. Reading sysfs. These are all the rules required to read sysfs. And since they don't show up in the, they don't all show up in, oops, in the list above, we know that some is not shown but still needed. so we're just assuming that part. Same goes for these sockets here that you see. For example, you know that it's basically reading the Netlink route socket, but not everything shows up. So we can just basically grab that from some other domain that's also reading the Netlink socket. That and that should have all of them, so that we don't have to do it the hard way. So here we have the Netlink route socket for Evo Cal Factory, and that basically these are all the permissions to basically read it. Oops, and this is Sisyphus, and made an error here. Of course, this is actually the other way around. I'll change that, don't worry. First this one, and then remove this one. And then just change this to the way it should be, this one. I made an error, but I am correcting it. And this is Sisyphus T. So yeah. Let's see what we have. So we have here the PROCnet network state, and we have PROC. So let's just go above and check out what we have for PROC, and then just add that for the the normal user also needs to read PROC. So we should add this one here. And then in the meanwhile, see if we have a rule for PROCnet T. PROCnet T. And we have here, that's not the same one. But anyway, so let's add the PROCnet T stuff of the PROC T. And then just adjust that. Reading PROC. It makes sense because this is a system monitor. So yeah, makes sense. And it's nice. I'm already doing it wrong again. And then just add this one in there. Because it's related. I could basically extend this. Let's just do that. PROCnet T, but I might want to require PROCnet T. Not sure, but let's just require that type PROCnet T, and then just remove the PROC and the PROCnet. The password file, we can just allow that reading password file. That's one that is complete. So let's remove that as well. And oh, we can also remove this one, the tempfs read write, and the password file. And so here we have some stuff with regard to it also reading or operating on deconf config home files, and it's also searching data. So we can basically go up and grab some of the similar stuff. So here we have these. Now, basically, I'm going to copy over this, all this stuff, but I'm not going to use it all, but copy that, and then just add that in, and then just remove the stuff that's not needed. So, a few white spaces, new lines. This one, we're going to need this. We already have this, but we're going to need at least these two and all this, and then just edit that, and then because you need to be able to search the home root to get to the deconfig home. That's just a fact, but it just doesn't show up by default, but we know that that's you. After a while you start to think like that, you know, to get somewhere you need to traverse certain places, and then you just can basically see the whole path it's traversing, and then just paste at that. And as for data home t, yeah, I know it's searching, I just don't know for what it's searching yet, but it's probably at some point saving a file there or reading a file there. So we're just adding this in, we're already getting a head start, so to speak. So we can remove all these, and we have a UDP socket that's being created. Let's see if we have in the past someone creating a UDP socket. So I'm going all the way up, and then you grab for UDP socket and see if someone creates it. And nothing creates it, so that sucks. So that's basically something that we have to go through the hard way. I guess. This one is also already taken care of. And now we have FS. This one should also be be added. And the same goes for stream connecting to dbus, which basically tells us that it's actually doing something on the session bus. So we must also check for dbus messages in varlog messages and the user AVC denials, because we know it's using the dbus. It's connecting to the user bus, so it doesn't do that just for its health. So here's systemd unit file. It's getting attribute of a dir with that type. Let's for now just allow that. But yeah, it's probably also traversing it, but we can't really we can't really assume that right now. So I'll just add it here, and that's something that we have to do the hard way. So with regard to it creating a sock file in the user temp, or in a directory with the user temp file. So let's see what that is. So let's just grab user temp t, grab create, or actually not create. Let's just look at the whole sequence. So it's creating a file, and it's a file with a random suffix, so we can't use a named file transition, but we can at least, oh, and we don't have to create a file context specification either. So this is just basically a simple normal file type transition for a sock file in a dir with user temp. So let's go back and create a a new type. So type gsysmon, and then I'll just call it empty, but yeah, let's just do that. And then this if assign a type attribute gsysmon temp t. It's not the real good right name, but previously it was stored in the temp directory. Now it's moved to run user. But and it's a file type, I guess, and a temp file type. And it's also a user temp type. So this might not be the best classification, but guess it'll have to do. So let's just have a look at some process that creates something in run user with a file type transition. And that's, for example, GNU keyring daemon. GNU keyring daemon does create something in temp with a transition. But where is it? Let's have a look. Here, it's not quite the same, and now you have the type transition. Not quite the same, but it's looking reasonably similar. Let's just copy that in. And then change that, adjust that to our requirements. We'll go through it anyways. So first, let's just adjust the source, which is not GNOME keyring daemon in this case, but GNOME sysmon. Just do that everywhere, and then just basically adjust that later. So let's look at the type transition first. The type transition looks pretty similar. Basically what it does is sysmon creates, instead of a dir, a soc file. So we'll change this to soc file. In dirs with user tempty, which is run user. And then we need to transition from user tempty to, and I'll just make it my login user, just like GNOME keyring daemon. Might come in handy later instead of just normal gsysmon tempty. So that's a type transition, that's taken care of. And then basically this is similar, it needs to create that socket, but then with the type gsysmon tempty. And then basically we need to write search rm dir. This is not quite needed here because we're not talking there. Now let's just take the one above. But remove stuff that we're not certain about. For example, I'm not certain that it actually reads or sets attributes of user temp. And read comes with open, and if it doesn't read, then it might not need to open. I'm pretty sure that it writes because it's created a socket in the run user, so it needs to write to the user dir, which is user temp t, to add the entry add name. And I guess it should also remove, but for some reason the sys monitor just doesn't remove its sockets. It just leaves them there once you quit the system monitor, which sucks. And I'm just not sure whether the lock and IO control are needed. So I'm just going to remove those as well. So it's basically just get attribute, traverse, write, add name, remove name. Where remove name, I doubt it. That it actually does that, but if it does, then we'll see it. So I'm not going to get ahead of myself here. So yeah, we have this stuff now done, and let's just say a small start. So save and exit that. Build that, and we have a. Oh right. It says here that it's a type, not an attribute. So we basically made an error, a syntax error, and it's about time I made those for a Monday morning. It should have already. So this here, this. Is an attribute, not a type. It was barking about that. It's more the class UDP socket needs to be required. And that's for create an IO control. It's the first time we actually use the UDP socket in this policy. So require that just above there, and should probably require that all the way on top anyways. Yeah, that seems to be right about right there. And we have an unknown type, well, a lot of errors. On 3783. So let's do a where is 3804, and we need 3783. 3774. Eight four, and here we have it. We didn't do that right either, and now we're loading. And we should remove this sock file for now, so that we can basically reproduce. First, the events when it doesn't exist at all. So that's lsrc run user 1012, and then there's its socket. Let's just remove it. It leaves it there for some stupid reason. It should just remove after it's done, but I guess. But there might be a reason why it's not doing that. RM. Yes, remove it. Let's have a look at the logs, see if we're clean. We are at 10.12 already. And there's nothing to do. So let's just do it. Wrong password. About time. Damn, this is the second time. That's terrible. So why am I not getting logged in? Do I have the caps lock on? Right, so somewhere I made a typo. I don't know exactly where. So at 10:14. It's pretty heavy on the CPU. And let's go ahead and see what new we have. So we have some other stuff here. So it actually wants to read that there as well. So it's not much. What we have right now. So let's just add this. So it might actually also need to set the attributes of that dir. So let's first deal with the stuff related to the type transition. So we have a read and an open. And then we have this random device. Let's add that all the way below. All right, save and exit. And just build that. And then just do it again, but then just move around a little bit in the program. Actually, maybe it's just a better idea to just try it now in enforcing mode and see, because we know that it's always preventing some stuff. And also what we need to do is take care of debus. We forgot that. So till and 300 for log messages. And then grab outer to allow, or need not grab, pipe that to outer to allow. See, we have some stuff here, so we can basically just use these and then we're done. So let's add these in. Let's just grab for my login. Well, actually we don't have to. We don't have to at this point. It's basically just chatting to the user bus. So we're going to just add these in and take care of these all the way below. so that at least it doesn't hang on debug before we're going to try it in enforcer mode. So these need to be done, these not, these. So let's go ahead and work. So basically move it around, you know the deal by now. It's a two-way system. You send a message to another domain, another domain sends a message back. At least most of the time. But that doesn't apply to chatting to the user bus directly to the actual user. So it's chatting to @SP2 and it's chatting to dconf daemon. It's chatting to GVFS. Or chatting with, not to, because it's a two-way system. Basically communications. And then once we add it, we allow that. Then we can basically just try and launch it in enforcing mode. But that's just the really the bare minimums because we haven't done anything yet in the program itself. We're just running it. Same with regard to the terminal, the GNOME terminal, we haven't actually tried to do anything yet in the menu. We haven't tried to create a profile, to edit a profile. So our search, let's see what we have at 1020. So as you can see, basically it's just we have everything we know to whom it chats. So everything is basically, there's integrity. We know exactly what it does. Oh yeah, and send a force, of course. What else? And it's not gonna work now. Oh, it actually does. But at least it'll show us some ABC denials, hopefully, that we haven't seen yet. So yeah, these two, not much, but some. So it's getting, it's doing something with UTEMP, I think it is. So let's grab GSysmon. See what Sysmon does. So this is its socket that it's messing with. Get attribute. But here it's searching. System D. This is probably Wow. what is it looking for? Let's just ls run systemd. Do we have a systemd directory in here? Yeah, we do. So this then probably is in its foreign t. Yep, it is. So it's messing in here. And it's, yeah, now I see it. So someone just decided to label some of this stuff in this directory with the systemd unit file type. Now, I don't like that at all. I don't like that at all. I think that's a very bad idea. So, but it does explain something. Let's go back. It does explain something. So it's probably, well, actually, let's just say that for generator, I think that's a bad idea. Although I'm not quite sure what the generator directory actually has, but for system that might actually be a unit file directory. So let's just go all the way back. 938, and then just grab system the unit file t. And then just see, and then less that, see if we can figure out what it's doing. Yeah, so it's actually with regard to system there. I think it might actually search that, but okay, now go back to the more recent. So now at least we know what's going on here. Let's just include that into our policy. So with regard to this stuff here, this is it's searching get attribute. Searching, but is it run systemd and then getting attribute of system in systemd there. Not sure whether it's actually doing anything else in there. And then we have get attribute of the sub file. That was created up. That's here. Get attribute. And then just make that. And it might actually, it actually builds. And load that into the system. So at least we are at a point where it's starting confined. And where it's basically creating its files with a proper type. So let's, just for shits and giggles, have a look at the process list and see that all the processes are still nice and confined. Just need to test that. We don't want any, because we were doing some stuff in permissive mode, so we need to, and then GNOME shell would be allowed to run generic binaries, but then it would run in the GNOME shell domain, obviously. So, but we're still we're still stable. We're still right. Cool. So, what we need to do now is basically get into permissive mode again, set enforce 0, then check our status, see if we're clean. And we're clean, and then just run it and do some stuff. So let's just go to the tab that basically allows you to manage the processes, because I know that's something. So processes, go to this tab here, there we go, and then we should basically be able to do a lot of stuff here. Kill processes, end processes, open files, memory maps, properties and stuff like that. So let's have a look what this gives us. So here we have what I expected, and so basically the same stuff that the user does when he runs stop. And here we have also other interesting stuff. We have it getting access to session T, which is actually we are in permission mode, aren't we? Yeah, 740. Because it's not, we're not actually asking for. We haven't configured the system monitor to list all processes, and that's why it's not trying to, I guess. We do have it searching C groups. Let's just allow that. We have to do a lot of stuff. So let's just really go through there step by step. So these are processes as far as I'm concerned. But this is actually the SysFS C group. So add that one in. It's the first time we have a process actually trying to get the C groups, I think. And so that's is related to SysFS, or at least that's also probably why. So we'll just add that here, and then require the C group T. Back. These are all processes. Processes. But these aren't. So the full CFS dir is probably run user 1012 DVS. We could actually verify that. Grab fuzzyfs. And yeah, that's actually this there. So it's getting attributes of it. Not sure if it's doing something else here. So just add that. Go back to our list. these are the all processes, and then we have here our own processes, so let's deal with that as well. So how are we going to deal with that? Well, we dealt with it in this also for our user, for top. So we can basically do the following. Add that. And then just make that separate section or separate block of policy. And then just allow the system monitor to only list processes for the user itself. So don't audit the get attributes. And here's a problem, because there is a big difference between our user applications domains and our actually user domain, and that's also where I was I figured that out later. Because we also have these booleans, these unconfined enable boolean and the numad enable boolean and the cg rules rule engines engine daemon boolean and the enable ksm tuned, and so I was currently only allowed to get the process state of the process of the user domain, but not of the user application domains. And I was wondering, why don't I see ABC denounced with regard to that? But that's basically because we classify all our user application processes types, domain types. And there is a coarse rule in Fedora policy that basically allows these domains, KSM tuned, NumaD, and well, that other one, and unconfined T, obviously, to basically get the process state of all domains. So that's basically why it's already automatically allowed to interact or to operate on these process state files. And the same goes with this here. If you look, here it's actually getting attribute of there. Oh, that's actually, fortunately, that's actually not allowed. So. So that's fine. Although it might actually need to be able to read to do this. So let's just allow these two as well. Although I'm not sure. And that's also for kernel T. That kind of sucks, because that will make the user be able to list the kernel threads as well as the init process, but it seems that system monitor wants to actually do that. Because, well, you can see it, that it's actually wanting more than just to get attribute. And that basically signals to us that it's different than the other processes. And we have a write to the SOC file here. So we can change that as well, edit that as well. Sock file. Back. And we have a read open security, so it wants to read security. And that's basically related to its listing. And it wants to remove name actually now. So that's neat. Okay, so let's also do that. Because we're there. So here it's remove name. So it actually tries to delete the sock file. Where was I? Security T. So let's just have a look at security T, because I know the user also has access to read security T files. So we can just allow that as well. So here we have that. Just allow these. Look, we're not in here to intentionally break this program. We just want to take care of integrity. We don't want to cripple it in any way. At least that's our preference. Just want to make sure that it does only what it needs to be doing. But what it needs to be doing, we want to allow that as much as possible. So here's systemd login d sessionsd. This is a file, probably a file we're going to use. So let's have a look at that. Or actually run lsalz run systemd. Here, this. And then sessions. And then we have files and FIFO files in there. And what does it actually want to do in our ABC denials? Actually a file. So it wants to read a file. So that means it also must traverse DIRS. So we basically going to allow this one here. And we'll do this below here, or actually where it's also doing the other systemd stuff. Where was I? Where was it? Here. We add that. But we also need to allow it to traverse theirs. That's just something that I know. Get attribute and search. Because you can't get to that file if you can't get to the you can't read the file if you can't get to it, and you need to traverse the login sessions there, and I think we already have that somewhere. So that's that. That's basically it so far. So let's save next, see if this builds. Builds. See if it installs. And now just basically have a look at what we are what we have if we are clean. 4-2. We're clean. And log in again. And open it again, and then just look at the file systems. So we can basically just allow all that it needs to do, because we can just basically prevent the user to run this in the first place. So we don't really have to worry about what the program can do, because we can just basically limit. The user, so that it can't actually get to him in the first place. So it seems it can already do everything it needs to get the file systems. That's probably because it has access to proc. So nothing new yet. System tab, process tab, resources tab, and file system tab. See if we can. We can't actually see anything here. Not here either. Although we could probably just enter these and set the colors, but let's just not do that for now. Search for open files, preferences. So let's search for open files. Actually, so this will basically run another program, I think, or maybe not. Let's just quit out and have another look, see what it's doing. These are all just simple processes. We have EBUS add that in, and we have more stuff. So we have this one here. And we have this one here searching for light D, and it makes sense, I guess. Because it wants to use the socket to connect to the... Oh, this is actually system bus though. Let's just allow the get attribute as well. Oh, anything else out of the ordinary? Doesn't look like it. This seems to be about it. So let's just save and exit this. Make it. And then install it. And then just try this in a forcing mode. See if send a force 1, and then just see if we're reasonably clear. We are. So let's just do this in a forcing mode. See where it gets us. So it is actually starting. It allows us to change steps. So we're seeing our own processes here. We have here the process tab. It kind of works, and we can get some information about that stuff. Search for open files. That works. Alright, see what AFC denials we're getting. So these are all nothing serious right now. But we haven't actually done much. This is just basically just looking at it, looking at the system monitor, but we haven't actually allow it to kill any processes or stuff like that yet. But we'll leave it at that for now, as in module B. What I'm going to do is basically log out and log in, and then just basically have a look at it again. So logging out. And then just do our kill and clear dance. Hopefully it's not too far back in my cache. Here we have kill. Do we have the clear also here? Yeah. And then the arm RF temp, and I'll do this manually. And let's all see. First, let's see if run user is clean for 10.12. Yep. And then let's all temp. And then just RM RF temp that pulls audio stuff so that it doesn't accumulate too much. So we have get and force. We have it enforcing. We remove the don't audit rule, so let's see if it's clear. I'll just use 1050. Audit to allow. We're clear. I'll append the last to that. And now I'm just basically going to log in like nothing happened. So I'm just a user, and I get come into the system. I just want to see the process state, but not from a shell, but from the actual GUI app. So I'm in here, and I get an AVC denial, which I'll dismiss for now. But it means that we're not quite there yet. I look at the file system, the resources, the processes. I'm not going to try to mess with the menu. Well, except for search for open files, I'll just open it. And then I'm just going to close it. See, there's more AVC denials. Dismiss. 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 A lot of AVC denials. So let's have a look. So we have some stuff here. We have this file descriptor inheritance and Ibis, that Ibis stuff that is. So let's just paste it here. Oh, paste this here. Ibis config home tdir search. And that's just the top of the iceberg, probably. I'll leave this one here. Varlib. That is basically related to it. Search. It probably wants to. Probably wants to stream connect to. I can just basically add that in here. Varlib. T. Because that's related. You need to traverse varlibd to get to systemdbusd varlibd. But that's all we see for now, so we really need to just get tested a little bit more. And let's also have a look and see if there's any Dbus related messages. It might be able, might want to chat to a system service rather than a user service. No, not yet. Till var, actually till n 100 var load messages. Audit to allow nothing, so I'm not sure why it's actually traversing systemd varlibd, but it is. Okay, let's see where we stand currently at 55. We're clean. See if we can reproduce some more if you see the denials. Yep, we can. Have a look, what do we have? I thought I already allowed that. I just deleted it. Might have just deleted that. Seems I just deleted that. That's stupid. So let's do this again. So basically we open it up. Go around a little bit. See the properties. Close that. Meanwhile, dismiss this one here. So let's just see what happens if we basically open the preferences. And let's just show, okay, let's show the security contacts. See if that works. It does. No ABC denials yet. So now we get the security contacts in the screen. Looks all snappy. And here you have the sysmon process, by the way. This is sysmon process, which eats up a lot of CPU currently. The shell as well. But then, let's just try and see all processes. And now we have some. So these are these kernel threads. These ext4d.io and write and stuff like that. And here you have kernel threads. But you don't, and you probably see init as well though. It looks a little bit ugly. That's init. Well, what the point is that you see other processes, but you don't see there much info about them. Let's just see. Oh, and now it's stuck. And it crashed. Yeah. At least it was able to crash. I think we got ahead a little bit too far. So here it wants to actually read case and tuned. Not sure why. As you troubleshoot, wants to read that. Nothing too. Yeah, this one is loud. Nothing too revealing though. Get attribute of the kernel process. And that's basically where it died. So the question is, should we allow it to, and I guess we should allow it to basically deal with init and kernel. So let's just do that. And I'm not sure why it's needing to read the KSM tuned. We need to don't audit the search of directories. Not sure why it's. So let's just allow KSM tuned and allow all these three to. And as it troubleshoot, geez. Okay, KSM tuned and as it troubleshoot. I see troubleshoot. So here we have that. No, not here. So KSM, GSM tuned, and SE trouble shoot. And then just also allow him to get attributes. Process get attribute. Sucks, but as a troubleshoot the daemon. Should we require as a troubleshoot D? Probably. Okay, and with regard to domains, don't allow it to search either. Let's see where this gets me. And we have a syntax error at type as a troubleshoot D. Yeah, that is right. That is right. Keep making that mistake. And KSM tuned is not within scope. That means, and that's because we basically in the past made that optional. So that we don't have to rely on it, depend on it, and that's why it's now crapping, because we basically forgot about all the dependencies now. But I'll just see if this works. Basically, ignore the dependency issues right now, for now. Later then, when we're cleaning up, then we're also taking care of the dependencies issues. It's low priority right now. Let's just click this so that let's just remove these icons. Okay, we have 1106 currently. And we have the abort applet appending to abort cache. So we'll look for A, B, T, abort cache, and it's appending to a file. And just make that, install that. So you see, while you're moving, you'll still find old AVC denials. Or the AVC denials with regard to other domains that you confined previously, but were not just not done right yet. So, 7. Clean. Now let's try this again. And now this ain't right. We're in permissive mode. G. We're in permissive mode. So what we're going to do now is just go into enforcer mode. Set enforce 1. And wait until we're clear. We were in permissive mode, so that was a wrong representation of the situation, because we don't want to list these processes. That's actually something we want to prevent on a system-wide level. We want the user to be able to manage and list its own processes, but not on a system level. And if we wanted to allow that, we should do that conditionally. But for now, we'll just deny that access. Okay, now let's just try that again. First, let's remove the SE troubleshoot. So we're here with the menu. Open it up, and now we have this stuff again. This not available, not available. These are all the processes that it can't basically list. But now it has some view of kernel. KSM tuned as well is also listed. Systemd. Let's have a look. And we're clean. So this is right. So yeah, you see some stuff like kernel threads, SE troubleshoot, init, KSM tuned. Those are the things that for some reason it just needs access to. Yeah, the kernel threads. But you don't see other users' processes. You also see a lot not. So these are, for example, system service processes that you can't see, and you don't get any ABC denials for that too. So that's something. Let's go to view and let's just try active processes, see if we have any ABC denials. None. And it's not crashing either, so that's also good to see. My processes, these are my processes, and everything seems to be running in the proper domain. Yeah, it's a little slow, a lot of access checks. Show all file systems. And here we have these, which we should probably don't audit. Does it crash when I do this? It doesn't seem to crash. But it doesn't show you any information about them either, so I like that. And you see the process is spiking. So let's just add these in. But we can probably make this in a single, do this in a single rule. But let's just space them in and see what they all have in common. So they're all FS file system types. So we could basically require attribute and let's just see what attributes we have in the system. SE info grab file system. I forgot the attribute name. Yeah, we have file system type, so we can use this attribute here. A file system unconfined type attribute, file system type, and file system unconfined type. Oh, actually, that's not needed. Just file system type is sufficient. And then just basically make a single rule that applies to all file systems. And my keys are sticky. So that should take care of that. Make that. And then just one final run, and then we can basically close this chapter for now with regard to system monitor. We still of course need to allow the user, or we could allow the user to set the schedule these processes, to set scheduler of its own processes, to kill its own processes, and other stuff. But we don't do this yet. This is for now, it's just viewing, and then later we can basically allow the user to actually manage his own processes. Not now. For now we're just keeping it simple. Oh, actually we allowed it and we need to don't audit it, the rule. So let's just go back. What am I doing? And make that a don't audit rule. Where is the file system type rule? This gen. So this is fuzzy, but we need the file system type rule. Where is it? Where did I put it? Here, all the way below, and don't audit this. I allowed it, but I don't want to allow it. Mistake. Where you work, you make mistakes. Oh yeah. And then just clear the processes. We get rid of the remaining processes, that VDA agent process, and also clear the home directory and stuff like that, and clear temp, and then just try this once more, and hopefully it'll be clean. would be nice. So that we can basically move on. Oh, and I'll just do this manually. So this is a small project for the Monday. Slow start, easy start. And that's good. Just slowly picking up the pace. We're getting force. And let's see if we have audit messages so that we can ensure that we're clean. You might also check, double check user AVCs just to be sure. And also till and 200 var log messages, audit to allow, just to make sure that we dealt with all dbus. Yeah, we did. Okay, so now just log in. First 11:19, that's it, we're clean. Let's just log in. Now we're logging in. We have this stuff here. It's not executing, and that's good. What's the idea? Yeah, this is the idea. It wasn't supposed to execute. I was just supposed to get rid of it. So we have the system monitor, we have the file systems, all processes. Let's see. We're clean. File systems, preferences. So here we have the show file, all file systems. So now it's showing them all, but doesn't actually show information about them all. But we have an AVC denial, dismiss, but have a look at it. Syscontrol FS, there. Searching that. Let's just for now allow that, or actually, yeah, just allow this for now, but we'll put it somewhere close where we know that it's related. So there's search get attribute. Make a build. Let's have a look if we can reproduce that. So basically what we did was view, or actually preferences, and show all file system on and off. See what if you have any exit in house. Not no new ones yet, but it's not searching sysfs syscontrol fsd for nothing, I can tell you that. But anyways, so basically you can view them, you can see some stuff, but you just can't see the status, how much they're used and stuff like that. But the other stuff works. View my processes. And I see that it actually removed my settings. But that's because I deleted the home directory. So that makes sense. Because it stores these settings. And I can actually see where it stores them. I should be able to see where it stores them. Because if you look at the policy, then you'll see if it writes to a file in the user home directory, then you can basically determine. Let's see where does it write to. Actually deconf. So I guess no, it doesn't write to deconf. I wonder where it stores that information. That's a good question. Should be storing it somewhere. But it doesn't write to anything, so not even deconf. It's just that socket. So that's kind of weird. Let's just log out and log back in. And now it hangs. Maybe it just, and that's probably how it does it. Maybe it just debus chats to some other servers and some setting servers, and the that other server stores it. Probably something like that. That's the only way I can basically explain it. So it doesn't have an actual own content. Yeah, no, we're really clean. at the moment. So I'm just assuming that it basically debugs chats to any of these services. Let's see if I can determine what might be the case. So here we have Sysmon. So etsp2, dconf, dvsd, so maybe any of these services, maybe dconf stores that information, or maybe etsp probably not, because I don't think etsp has some information, or has that information. No, don't save. LS home, my login user, and then LS all. So that should probably go into config, and then you have dconf, for example, dconf, and then there's this user file. Oh, it's a binary file, so I can't open it. I don't want to open it. Don't want to screw up my terminal. But okay, suffice to say that it does store it somewhere, that information, because it was still having the old information in there. But I don't know how it stores that information. Search for open files. No. Oh, and we have an AVC denial. Dismiss that. Have a look. Did it crash as well? No, it didn't crash. Oh, it's actually reading now. So let's add that as well. It's actually reading the DIRS now. The system state, the process state DIRS. So here we have open. Actually, to read it, you also need to open it. That's the deal. So that's also with regard to the user. Makes sense. Open. To actually read it, you also need to open it. So yeah. Makes sense. But anyways, we'll leave it at this. It works pretty nice. There's always some stuff that needs to be done. For example, like I said, you'll also want to allow users to basically whoops. Oh, and here we already have a permission denied. Kill sit, you want to be able, the user to be able to kill, continue, and stop, change priorities and stuff like that. And now you can see that it's actually denied. But yeah, eventually you want to basically allow that, I guess. So where do we have the kill? Here it's sending the stop signal. So you can basically, what you can do is allow signal perms, sick kill, sick stop, and all that stuff, and then you'll basically allow the user to manage its processes from the system monitor. But we are not going to do this now. I just want to have the basics. So let's just also open a shell. Let's see if there's some. So now we have a shell also open, and we have 11:31. And here we have stuff related to the shell. GNOME shell. This is GNOME shell actually. Where is G shell? And this is, we need to make sure that it's actually GNOME shell though. Less. Because GNOME shell runs stuff. Yeah, it's actually GNOME shell. And it's setting attribute of G output stream. So yeah, we need to allow that. And this is G shell data home T set attribute of file remove name of dir. So G shell data home T remove name from remove name and set attribute. Now it wants to unlink. But I'm not going to allow that anyways. See if we can reproduce it though. And we can't reproduce it. That's always a shitty thing. You get one try and then let's see where we have the GNOME terminal in here in this list. This is the bash shell which runs in the user domain, and here you have the GNOME system monitor, and here you have the terminal. And somewhere should be the PTI helper as well. Here's the PTI helper. So no, we can't reproduce it, so we have to wait for that. But anyway, now what you would expect is that PSAUX would show also the kernel threads, because you allowed it in the system monitor. But since the system monitor runs in the sysmon domain, you can't actually do the you can see the kernel threads in the system monitor, but you can't see them if you use the PSAUX command. So that's reasonably nice. You have these different domains, so different behaviors depending on how you list the process states. If you do it with top or with PSAUX, then you get a different behavior than when you do it with the system monitor. And I basically did that because I really have an idea that it might system monitor just might need access to actually search look up the kernel process state and the init process state. So that's why I just allowed it, because yeah, I just noticed some behavior that made me think that it was better to just allow that. So start that up again. See if we have anything else, and then I'll just yeah, we do have something rename, and that's for the file, that's GNOME shell data home file. shell. So GNOME shell data home file rename, and then probably we'll be able to reproduce it further. But you can notice that the system is getting slower. The more policy you add, the slower it gets. But on a system where this is just important, it doesn't really matter, because well, you'll have to pay for it a little bit. Wasn't able to reproduce it yet. In a system where it's important to we're done, I think. So yeah, two graphical user interface user programs confined now, the terminal and the system monitor. So we're steadily progressing in this virtual machine, because if you run this, for example, on a laptop, you try this policy on a laptop, it's obviously not going to work, because laptop also has a power manager applet, and you might have Bluetooth, which will show up icons here, but those aren't supported yet in this policy, because this policy is basically designed in a virtual machine that only has a particular set of processes running. Similarly, this policy won't work on Fedora 19, because that uses a different GNOME version. And I tried it, I asked someone to basically try it, to just have an idea of the stuff that would need to be supported just to get it going. And there were some new processes. I think it was some GVS processes that get started by default that weren't supported, so it's failed to start up. And same with different virtualization technologies, because that guy also used VirtualBox or whatever, and I'm not sure what it's called, or maybe it was that other proprietary software. But this policy supports VD agent, which is basically the KVM LiveVirt virtual desktop agent, and not the ones from the other virtualization technologies. So yeah, to test this, it's really very limited. You really need to just test it with Fedora 18 and with a reasonably default setup, although I did support for a bit the DNSSEC monitor, which is not default. And then you also need to test it in LiveVirt or KVM, so you can't use any other virtualization technologies, because else those agents are not supported, and that might crash your system. That might actually crash your system. And so you can only use this with Fedora 18, not 19, or 17 for that matter, because there's just differences in GNOME, and so that might just cause the stuff to not boot. But if you have F18, Fedora 18 up to date, and you have a libvirt KVM QMU system, then you can just try it out, and you should have the same results as I have here, because I pretty much tested it pretty thoroughly, at least pretty quote pretty unquote. I tested some scenarios, and so should have the same results, I guess. So this is it for today, I guess, because I'm going to start slowly this week. Last week I did a lot of work, but this week I'm going to take it a little bit easier, step by step, no rush, just enjoy what you do. So yeah.